The future of research and innovation. What is Germany's plan? In the interview, German Education Minister Johanna Vanka.
Minister, you have a PhD in mathematics. Why do you love math so much?
Math is wonderfully logical. You can work out a lot for yourself. I always found math easy at school. I won awards and it was fun. I considered studying German, but I came from former communist East Germany, and back then, math was better because it was more disconnected from the political system.
And can that same mathematical logic be applied to politics?
Things aren't always logical in politics. But I think it's true. As a scientist, you try instinctively to analyze and think systematically in politics and look beneath the surface.
Some experts say German research is in a better state than at any time since the Second World War. Do you agree?
Yes, I think so.
Why?
We're highly efficient. Our universities have made a name for themselves. We have major research institutes alongside the universities. We're very strong in pure research, too. And we've managed to significantly improve the transfer of knowledge to business and industry. There's still potential for growth. But when I just think of the number of people doing PhDs, the number of publications, we've seen tremendous growth in recent years. Also, in top-level research, there are many fields where we are among the global leaders.
And why is that so important for Germany?
We don't have any raw materials, such as diamonds or mines. So we have to prosper with what we do have, human resources, innovations, German engineering. That's the basis of our success. So creativity, education, development. That's the basis for what's grown in Germany over the past decades.
So if things are that good, you could just lean back and say, it's all great.
I think that would be fatal, because the international competition is very tough, and countries that haven't been so strong in the past are now making enormous efforts to catch up. So it's important that we work hard to retain or even increase our competitive edge in the area of science and research.
What form should that hard work take?
Many forms. During the financial and economic crisis, when spending on research was cut in many parts of the world, we actually increased our investment. So finance is one thing. But we have to invest it wisely, and we have developed new strategies for that in recent years. For example, at non-university research institutes, looking at how to focus on key areas that are important for the future and where we have strengths, agenda processes, monitoring processes. Then there's international contacts. In 2008, we saw the German government for the first time introducing a strategy to internationalize research in Germany and promote cooperation with scientists around the world.
You mentioned key areas. Which areas are they? Where can Germany excel?
For example, the area of health, healthy living, nutrition, the area of sustainable economic management and energy. Then there's the digital economy and society. And then innovations in the working world of tomorrow. People can only perform well if they're not worried about new developments, about their qualifications not being recognized anymore, but instead have the chance to see the opportunities there could be in reorganizing the way we work. Maybe a lot more freedom, for example.
You mentioned the government's internationalization strategy. How can or should Germany work with other countries?
Science is by nature international. Experts in any given field will always try to work together. Half of all publications that have been written in Germany have been produced in cooperation with international partners. We are an export nation. An export world champion. We have massive exports and imports, and that only comes by working with other countries. The government's internationalization strategy basically worked out rules on how we want to set up field offices for non-university research institutes, for example. How we can focus on certain fields for large-scale research equipment. I've just been to CERN, for example. It's the only accelerator plant of its kind in the world. No single country could finance that.
The particle accelerator in CERN?
The particle accelerator in CERN. And the question for us is how to organize this cooperation. Which countries should we work with? These are questions that can't be decided in Germany alone. Then there's the demographic development. In Africa, there are countries where half the population is under 18. Our own society is aging. In the coming years, we will need to attract more skilled workers from abroad. We need to reach out to them. We want good people, real experts. These things are important. And another reason why we need internationalization strategies.
But still, we always hear that Germany is not the first choice or even the second or third choice for researchers from abroad. What's the problem? Why is Switzerland or the US more attractive?
That was the problem for many years. When I was a university rector in the 90s and the beginning of this millennium, we were often criticized because of all the young people going to the US or elsewhere. We were considered unattractive. But that has changed in recent years because of the many efforts made in this area. Now we're the third most popular country worldwide for international students after the US and Britain. So we are the most attractive non-English speaking country for students worldwide.
Die größte Anzugskraft für Studenten aus aller Welt. Das war vor einigen Jahren nicht so.
And another thing. Many surveys have shown that young Germans who go to the US, for example, to gain experience in life sciences, health, which is a good thing to do. Two-thirds of them return to Germany after a while. So the situation is vastly different now to 10 or 15 years ago when we were often criticized.
So Germany is in again.
That sounds a bit over the top, but we are in a good position, yes.
Despite the German language, which was often considered an obstacle.
Yes, that is a handicap, and that's why the English-speaking countries have an advantage. But I also support the idea that we should still use German as well as English in the area of science and continue to preserve that. And many students come because of the language to study German, and because Germany is a strong economic nation, the fourth largest in the world, which makes it interesting for many young people. Right now, it's working well.
Es funktioniert zurzeit sehr gut.
You mentioned Africa earlier. In what fields could you imagine scientific cooperation there?
We held a major conference here in the spring, an Africa conference, and political papers from each African state, from their research organizations, were analyzed in advance. We had, I think, around 230 African scientists here, along with German scientists engaging in dialogue on an equal footing. And that led to a new Africa strategy. It's not focused on development policies, on us helping, but on us working together with African scientists as equal partners on things which are important to them, where we have strengths and where they have strengths. And we identified 30 major projects which are now starting up.
The outbreak of Ebola has, of course, cast a shadow over Africa. What can Germany do to help?
Germany is already trying to help and to provide humanitarian assistance. We have put out an appeal for volunteers. We're looking, of course, for qualified nurses and doctors, especially those who have experience with infectious diseases. We're also helping to provide equipment, mobile clinics, etc. That's all happening, and it's a form of humanitarian support in a difficult situation. But you can also help by educating the public about the virus. You have many opportunities to help with that, and especially in this difficult situation, we've noticed that that's just as important as fighting the virus on the ground with qualified personnel.
So at the moment, the lack of knowledge is still considerable, and there's a lot of fear involved. In Germany, too?
Yes, of course. In Germany, people are also afraid when there's a new health threat, be it bird flu or whatever. I think that's quite normal. It's an instinctive reaction. But public education is important, as is scientific research in this area. Our ministry is conducting research into poverty-related diseases, which are, of course, especially prevalent in Africa.
Was something like this to be expected?
There were years when there were only one or two cases of Ebola. It hasn't been constant. So I think the scale of this epidemic probably could not have been predicted, but I'm no specialist on that.
Mrs. Vanka, you grew up in communist East Germany, did your PhD there. November 9th will be the 25th anniversary of the fall of the Berlin Wall. Do you remember that time?
Of course. I lived there for 40 years. 40 years of socialization very much shapes the person you are. I'm still happy that we have a reunified Germany. And of course, I can remember November 9th, 1989. But I've often said that the most important date for me was October 9th, 1989. 2 days before was the 40th anniversary of the East German state, and the party leadership had banned the public rallies that were being held each Monday in Leipzig and were growing in number.
We're the people.
They positioned ambulances on the exit roads from Leipzig. They brought in extra supplies of blood for all the hospitals. The demonstration was banned, but on that day, more people came to the rally than ever before. So it was the day that the wall of fear fell. And then came November 9th, and our son was amazed to find us worrying that everyone would just leave and we wouldn't be able to change things here. I still see it as an opportune moment that we could not have predicted.
Thank you for talking to us.
You're welcome.